Yes, she is. I had pizza for dinner.
I'll call the meeting to order. Welcome you all to our regular meeting, number five of the 95-96 year, this date of September 11th, 1995. The roll call, please, by the town clerk.
Chairman Cogsall.
Here.
Counselor Chapel.
Here.
Counselor Jordan.
Yeah.
Counselor Linnell.
Here.
Counselor McGinty.
Here.
Counselor McLaughlin.
Here.
And Counselor Reed.
Here.
I'd invite you all to join us for the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We have citizens' discussion period of items not on the agenda. There being none at the moment, we'll move on to reports and correspondence. Any reports, Counselor Linnell?
Yeah, I just have an announcement. The Republican County Committee meeting, which was scheduled Tuesday the 19th, it was going to be at the Cape Middle School cafeterium, but the location of that meeting has changed. It will be at the Cape United Methodist Church around the corner from Jonesy's, for those that don't know. And there will be a potluck supper that's $6, and there will be representatives from the all the Republican candidates for president there. So anyway, the location again is, it's not going to be at the middle school cafeterium. It'll be at the United Methodist Church. Thank you.
In the spirit of nonpartisanship, are there any Democrat Party announcements or Green Party announcements?
No, there are not.
Okay. Any other reports of correspondence? Councilor Reed.
An announcement, Madam Chair, that the P2 committee is meeting Wednesday at 7:15 in the town hall, that the meeting is open to the public. We are, among other things, looking at proposed bikeways or potential bikeways in the public way, and Two Lights Road is on our agenda to be looked at on Wednesday, among others.
Thank you. Any other reports or correspondence? Mr. McGovern?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. A couple of quick announcements. Last month at the council meeting, you authorized $19,500 expenditure for some additional sewer line work that needed to be done as part of the school project, or as a result of request by the town having done the project. I'm pleased to report that that was the engineer's estimate, and the actual cost estimate came in at $11,809. So that's more good news coming from the school project. Second, would like to briefly bring everyone up to date on the finances for the school project. It continues to be within the budget that was originally approved by the voters. It is fully expected to be within the budget approved by the voters. It has gone very well. I think, as everyone is aware, the students are now back in school. There's very nice looking facilities. A lot of folks worked hard to do that. A number of school personnel, the architect, the clerk of the works, all our town departments helped out. But there are two groups in particular that I would like to recognize for their work, and those are the school custodians and the school bus drivers. All summer long, as well as over the last 2 years, they've been under a special burden with trying to keep the schools clean. And I think just did a tremendous job, and particularly did a tremendous job over the last month of August, as anyone who walked inside the schools during that period could see that they were needed a lot of work. And the bus driver and the custodians were right out straight unloading trailers and school furniture back into the schools, as well as cleaning up after the contractors, something that the contract will be giving us a credit for as a result of the school's personnel work. So I'd like to recognize the custodians and the bus drivers in particular for all their hard work over the last few months. Third, would like to mention, we had the annual town golf tournament a couple of weeks ago, and they have different awards for different aspects of it, and the person nodding next to me kind of surprised I'm announcing this. I had the longest drive on the seventh hole out of all the men and women in the tournament. Want to congratulate Phyllis on the longest drive in the tournament.
We won't say what prize I won last year. On to the minutes of meetings number 3 and number 4 of 95 and 96. Any additions or corrections to those minutes?
Will they be accepted as printed?
Second.
I believe our clerk gave us an additional page. You all have those tonight? Okay.
Yes.
All in favor? It's a 7-0 on each. We'll now move on to our public hearing on the proposed amendment to the traffic schedule relating to parking within the intersection of Bowery Beach Road, Route 77, and Crescent View Road. Mr. McGovern, do you want to give just a little bit of background, please?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. This is a proposed no parking in the area. So I think the best way to describe it is around the ice cream stand. As you go down Ocean House Road or Kettle Cove Road, that's a triangular piece of property, and it's proposed to have no parking on either side of the triangle. This came about as a result of a citizen complaint about the safety on particularly the side of the ice cream stand where the ice cream window is. It's very tight going through there, and when there were vehicles parked there, it caused some concern, particularly with some of the little kids that are customers of the ice cream stand, and this was proposed for safety reasons. The specific provision is that there be no parking along this section of road from May 1 to October 1, period.
Okay. Are there any comments from the public? If so, please come to the microphone and give us your name and address.
My name is Robin A. Clough, and I reside at 1A Crescent View Avenue. I also own property located at 1 Crescent View Avenue. And my son, Robert Rutter, and myself own 548 Ocean House Road. Those are three out of the five houses that surround that triangle. And quite honestly, I guess I am here to lend a little bit of support to a small business person. I have lived on that corner for 38 years, and quite honestly, I don't see a major concern. I see a very well-behaved, for lack of better words, small business. I have people sitting on my lawns all day long throughout that same period of time. I have very little problem controlling any public concerns. If they throw my trash or feed my dogs or et cetera, I simply ask that they don't do that. If they are parked up on the side of my lawn, I don't have a problem with that. The small road that is between the front of my home, which is the big white farmhouse, and my home is the white farmhouse, and the small road is the only thing separating me from that ice cream takeout window. And I see people that pull up there and park for maybe 2 or 3 minutes, 4 or 5 minutes, long enough to grab their ice cream, and everybody is trying to abide by the simple rule of staying off from the road. I think where that road is, or Route 77, is accessible by going up to Ocean House Road and turning left or right, I think the general public could, you know, do what they are trying to do and stay off from the tar and use an alternate route, which is available. I think it's unfair to put a squeeze on a small businessman when he's just there during this proposed time period and he's trying to make a living. And quite honestly, I personally don't have a problem with it. So I just wanted to share that. Thank you.
I'd like to just ask you a question because we have in the past had some discussion about the possibility of just shutting off that particular section of the road so it wouldn't be a through road onto Old Ocean House or Crescent View. Mm-hmm. And it would be sort of dead end just beyond the driveway. Mm-hmm. Have you given any thought to that approach?
Shutting it off completely. I guess my alternative would be
So you would not be able to go through from 77 to Old Ocean House Road?
Correct.
Directly in front of your house?
Right.
They would have to come around the corner?
I'm sure that's an option. Personally, I think part of the problem could be alleviated by making the road a one-way street. I think the concern, or my opinion is, maybe the concern arises when you have cars parked on both sides. They're up onto the edge of my lawn, or they've tried to pull off from the road onto the parking lot of the ice cream stand. And that is, in my opinion, where the problem arises, when two cars cannot pass at the same time. I have never personally seen the road blocked to a point where it is not passable. And, I mean, I sit right there in that house. I have large windows. I sit on the front porch. And I think for the most part, people are very responsible with their children. The children are not playing in the road. They are not crossing the streets by themselves. So that's kind
Thank
of,
you.
Okay.
Anyone else?
My name is Francis Cook. My wife owns the takeout. A short while ago, Mr. McGovern came by and said he had a complaint from a neighbor that somebody took their children up on his lawn to urinate on the lawn, which doesn't really have too much to do with traffic. But he thought maybe that if we didn't have people parking out there, that we could alleviate that kind of thing. When the proposal came out to just ring me with no parking signs, it came as a little bit of a surprise. And I would personally like to have it tabled at least until I can sit down with somebody and talk about some alternatives. I think that no parking all the way around is too much of a squeeze. And one way would be one of the things that I think would be a good idea. But I am definitely opposed to no parking on all sides of the building. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? There being no other public comment, I'll close the public hearing and we'll discuss item number 42. To consider a proposed amendment to the traffic schedule relating to the parking within the intersection of Bowery Beach Road, Route 77, and Crescent View Road. Council discussion?
Could I clarify one point?
Yes.
Mr. Cook made mention that I was proposing this in order to avoid folks urinating on lawns. If you look at the memo that I gave to the council, you look at, all the discussions we had on this the previous meeting, all of the discussions I had with our public safety personnel, that issue never arose, and, it was something I passed on to Mr. Cook as something the neighbor had complained about. It is not any justification at all that I give for this proposal.
Okay. Councillor Jordan, you were about to say something.
No, I just have a comment in your discussion with the police department and what have you. Was there any discussion as far as making it a one-way?
Mr. McGovern?
We have had discussions about closing it. We've had discussions about one-way. We had discussions about this. There's issues of closing it when then you remove people's frontage. In essence, make them non-conforming lots that can begin to be a problem. As to the one-way, our experience is, one-way streets don't slow cars down at all. They tend to speed them up, and the real issue for us was the fact that, there is parking. It is congested, and as my memo of August 7th indicates, at the time after I got the complaint, went down there, And, you know, I thought I was going down for routine citizen complaint. Even while I'm standing there, a couple of vehicles pull up during the time I'm standing there, and their little toddlers are running back and forth on that street. During the entire time I was there, most of the parking area used by the ice cream stand that runs along the Bowery Beach Road fence was empty. I also have spoken to Mr. Cook, you know, more than once, you know, I spoke to him again last week, indicating that, you know, since we had put emergency no parking signs along this section, had it harmed the business at all? And he indicated that it had not. You know, the last thing we would want to do is hurt the small business. You know, what we're trying to do is to provide for the public safety.
Well, I understand as far as the public safety goes and what have you, but the one-way deal I don't think would work too well, because it all depends which way it goes, I guess. That would be the, because it used to be the Gardner residents there would, in order to get on to 77, would have to go down around, or they'd be going the wrong way on a one-way street just to get out that driveway. They're the driveway that's first one in on the right. I didn't say it'd be illegal to dart out there, but it would be against the ordinance if it was a one-way deal. So I don't know. I for one, don't want to hurt the business and what have you, and I have been down there when they've been cars on both sides of the street and what have you, and you've got to watch yourself as you get through, so. And this only goes from May 1st to October 1st. That is the way I read it, is that correct?
It's a seasonal, yes.
Yeah, seasonal.
And, you know, if you read the ordinance, technically, we already banned parking from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. in this section anyway. All we're really talking about doing it is extending it around the clock. You know, but the signs had never been posted for the period from 9 to 6. We already banned parking there from 9 to 6.
Councilor Reed.
I have a question. Mr. McGovern, all the abutters were notified of tonight's town meeting?
Correct.
Public meeting, excuse me. And the person who lodged the complaint was the only negative about the parking? The people that are here are all,
That's right.
It the way it is?
I can't speak. Not everyone has spoken, but
of those who spoke.
Yeah.
I'm just not comfortable voting to make a change right now until we, or at least I further have further information about the one way. I live up there. I go by there probably four times a day, and I would hate to vote to do something that would limit that business during their peak season.
Councilor Linnell.
I remember reading and talking about the possibility of having the parking on one side, and I think the discussion was if you just put it on one side, somehow it would complicate things. And I'm wondering if the parking was just on the side of the takeout, what was the thinking? Why would that not be an option, or what was the thinking behind? I'm suggesting maybe, you know, one option just on the side of the takeout, on one side.
You know, if you look at the width of the pavement there, if they park on one side, a vehicle can barely get through going in the opposite direction. If they're parked over in the lawn, that's fine. But, you know, it, when, you know, I was taught as a very young child that you don't go out between parked cars, and you know that's the
it's
very congested there. It's a fast way to Kettle Cove, and
right.
I just, you know, I don't feel that strongly about this, but in good conscience after observing it there that day, I just felt compelled to immediately post it, emergency no parking, and to bring this proposal before you. It was, you know, my observation of it, and further discussions with our public safety personnel. I had to put public safety before any concern, you know, that it might harm the business a little, but even then, I'm not convinced that it harms the business in any manner.
Thank you.
Other comments? Councilor Jordan?
Did I read in your memo there, when you was there, that they were parked on the streets and there was nobody parked in the parking lot at that time?
There were two vehicles in the parking lot, you know, along that Bowery Beach section. There may have been some employees parked over in the back on the other side. And there were two to three cars parked in this section of road.
Councilor McGinty?
I tend to agree with Councilor Reed that I go by that location often enough that I've never seen it as a major problem. In fact, I've parked there myself. And also, if this has been a regulation that's been on the books that there should be no parking there, and for whatever period of time nobody's seen fit to post it or enforce it, it seems to me that it can't be that much of a problem. And I could certainly look at some options of changing the road, you know, traffic patterns there or whatever, but I don't think I could support this as it's written, no.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Chapel.
I've been going to that takeout now since Mrs. Clough owned it, which is a long time ago. And it's been a parking problem since day one, but we've lived with it. And I can't, after thinking about it and studying what we have here, we have the parking, no parking already in effect. The only thing we're changing tonight is putting up signs, and I'm not sure I can go along with that. And I don't want to see a business that happened to grow and got bigger and bigger, and I don't want that to hurt them just because they got bigger. I kind of admire them for it and what they've done down there. It's very clean run operation every time that I've been by. The yard is picked up, and I think we've got to do something else and study it a little bit further about one way, parking on one side, cutting off one road but leaving the other one. I think there's a lot of ifs to it, so I couldn't go along with backing this tonight. Thank you.
Councilor Linnell.
I have some just mixed thoughts about it. I think that I'm reluctant to stand in the way of a small business person. I think there are some safety issues there, though. I think it's a wonderful place to go get an ice cream in the evening, and there's a very nice atmosphere there, very relaxed, and I think that's good for business. And I also think there is a potential for toddlers and whatnot, kids, you know, it's just such a relaxed place that it's almost like a playground. And so I guess I'd like to look at it a little further. So I'd like to, if I may, introduce a motion to table it until...
Are you doing that?
Yeah.
Until what?
Until we have a chance to perhaps sit down with the business, the people from the Cape Takeout, and just kick it around a little more, and maybe, I guess my motion will be, let's table it until further notice, or, and then we'll talk about it.
Is there a second to that? No discussion, either seconded or it dies.
Oh, so I'll second that.
All in favor of tabling? 4-3. Those opposed? You opposed
to
tabling?
I'm against tabling it, yeah.
So it's 3 against. Perhaps we should just enforce what's already there, Michael. Could we have the Public Works Director and the Police Chief come up with some alternative suggestions?
Yes, we will.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, can I just make a comment? I would like to thank the manager for his efforts and concern on this. I think this is something to look into, and I'm glad he brought it to our attention.
Item number 43, to consider a report from the Planning Board upon a citizen request to amend a provision of the zoning ordinance relating to wetland setbacks and take any necessary action. Mr. Emery, would you, instead of asking a counselor, since you're chairman of the Planning Board, would you like to just make a comment? Introduce this, please.
Yes. Tom Emery, 12 Juniper Lane, Planning Board Chairman. Good evening, Madam Chairman and counselors. As you know, the Planning Board at its August 15th meeting recommended amendment to the zoning ordinance with respect to the critical wetland buffer in the RP1 zone. Mr. and Mrs. Cole had petitioned the town council for relief from that ordinance, and I believe that you have a sketch of the plan that was submitted. In essence, they have a house that they wanted to add a 6-foot by 9-foot entrance vestibule to the front of the house. The house is adjacent to an RP1 wetland, and that addition fell within 90 feet. The current ordinance requires that any expansion within the RP1 wetland buffer take place to a non-conforming structure at the farthest non-conforming location, which in the case of the Coles residence would have placed it at the far back corner of the house. This is the second time that the council has forwarded a concern similar to this to the Planning Board. At our last recommendation to the council, we recommended an ordinance amendment that was fairly consistent with the state shoreland zoning, and have done so with respect to this amendment. After a workshop and public meeting with respect to this, or a regular meeting with respect to this issue, the Planning Board has forwarded the recommendations to the council, which state that for structures located in the Resource Protection 1 critical wetland buffer, no building footprint expansion shall be permitted which is located closer than the shortest non-conforming setback distance from the wetland upland edge. For structures located in the Resource Protection 1 critical wetland buffer, no building footprint expansion shall be permitted which is located closer than 25 feet from the wetland edge. The previous language had a graphic example in the zoning ordinance under Appendix D. That appendix will also be necessary to amend if the council elects to take the Planning Board's recommendations. I'd be happy to answer any questions if you may have them.
Are there any questions of Mr. Emery? Thank you very much for getting this back to us as quickly as you have. And what we need to consider is this needs to be forwarded to our ordinance committee for their review. Sorry, but that's the next step, John.
So moved.
Counselor.
Second.
Okay. Counselor Reed, do you have a comment?
I was going to ask the chairman if, in addition to the ordinance committee, do we also vote to set this to public hearing at the October 11th meeting?
I believe that that is not the usual sequence, that we need to have specific language that we set for public hearing, and at this moment we do not know that that's the recommendation of the ordinance committee.
Is there a possibility that, in light of the building season, that the ordinance committee that meets this
tomorrow.
Week, tomorrow, would be able to take an action so that there could be a public hearing on October 11th?
We have to have specific language that we set for public hearing. We do not have that recommendation from the ordinance committee yet.
And how long would that take? Is that a month process? Is that a two-meeting process?
It could be. It could be four or five.
Well, I think the question is, if we handle this tomorrow, and we agree on language, and how much time is needed then?
That was my question. Thank you, John.
You have to have a month for the public hearing. So come back for our October meeting.
You have to give 7 days' notice for a public
hearing. 7 days' notice. Okay.
So potentially we could, if we...
We could have a...
If we can get it out of the ordinance committee tomorrow, potentially we could have a public hearing then on...
We would have to have another town council meeting to set the public hearing.
We happen to have a workshop scheduled 2 weeks hence, I believe. We could have a regular item agenda at that workshop to set it to public hearing for October 11th at that time. So I think I would suggest that we leave the motion as made stand and consider a quick regular meeting agenda prior to our workshop coming up in a couple of weeks. See if it's ready.
Councilor Jordan.
Yes. Would we be allowed to take an item out of order at the end of the agenda to set the public hearing? Is that allowed for an ordinance?
We're just having a workshop on the 11th, but we would now schedule a regularly advertised town council meeting for that item.
Yeah, I understand that, all right, but I'm just wondering whether you're allowed to take an item out of order at the end of the agenda to set a public hearing.
I'm confused.
What is he talking about?
Isn't the October 11th meeting our regularly scheduled meeting? And our workshop meeting is...
We have one in September.
Right, so the workshop that we...
We have one the 25th and the 28th, Janet, that's what it was.
25th.
And the 28th.
And the 28th?
Just sewer fee thing.
Oh, phew.
So we could quickly have a town council meeting, the 25th, before we have our planning board ZORC committee workshop. And that would be more than 7 days before our October meeting. Does that answer your question, Billy?
Yep, it's okay. Ready to go?
I was thinking, yeah, with the deadlines in the newspaper, to get it in that week, and since it's Wednesday instead of the Monday, that helps in the timing, so you should be all right.
Yeah, you should be. You can get in.
Any other questions?
Move the question.
Right. That's what I was doing. All those in favor of forwarding this to the ordinance committee? Gives me great pleasure to do this.
Thank you very much.
That's where we stand now. On to a next item. To consider scheduling a public forum to discuss options for town sewer fees and take any necessary action. This is item number 44. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, a number of citizens have come to meetings in recent months requesting that the council give some consideration to alternative sewer fees. The purpose of this forum would be to outline several different options that the town could look at, including reducing the minimum fee, compensating for that by increasing the incremental fee, or the amount that one uses per 100 cubic feet, doing away with the readiness to serve charge that is assessed, and considering doing away with the per meter fee for multi-unit apartments. And what I'd propose is that you schedule a forum for the public to discuss different options, and you know, we'd make presentations that evening so they could understand what some of the different proposals that could occur, that you could then take the public forum comments and deliberate at some point how you might wish to proceed.
What sort of a forum do you envision?
I envision a informal meeting with a presentation as to what our revenue requirement is as contained within the budget, an explanation of what our current fee is, how it compares to other community fees, why ours is higher than other communities, then looking at different options, all of which would reduce the minimum monthly charge, and most of which would compensate for that by increasing the incremental charge. no specific proposal will be made that evening. It will be laying out of options and soliciting public input.
And you're planning on having an article in the Cape Courier prior to that, if possible?
We would hope to receive cooperation from the Cape Courier in having an article, yes.
And were you also planning on perhaps televising it?
Had not discussed that, but that's...
It was mentioned in the workshop that that might be a forum for some people.
I'll speak to Harry Proudman and get him to schedule it.
Question, Janet. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. At some point, would it be possible for us to have a town, somebody designated as one of the town employees? I don't know who it's going to be. I'm not going to look at you. For people to call or come in with their sewer bill and say, yes, under option A, this is what it would be for you, under option B, under option C. I think that's the way people understand it, if they see how it relates to their own usage situation. And if we could make somebody available to do that, hopefully not take a lot of staff time, but I think that is a key component of educating the public on this. And I'm not going to look. Sorry.
We are going to be at our lowest staffing levels in the next 2 weeks because of a combination of factors. So,
taxes.
Yeah, I'm hesitant to obligate the troopers that will be really carrying the day.
Maybe we have some counselors here who don't work full time and could volunteer to do that.
But let me say this: this packet, we will make many copies of it with what the different options are, and I think anyone can easily figure out where they might stand, and we'll. We'll put this on the counter for anyone that wishes to have it. And
parts of this packet are confusing. We discovered that at workshop.
You know, usually I sit down with folks, but as you know, I'm going to be out. So, and
can you make up some simpler diagrams, breakdowns, perhaps?
Yeah, I really don't like disclosing my schedule.
I know.
I'm leaving town in the morning.
In time for us to, no, we can hold them up for the television cameras, Michael.
Oh, they'll be ready by the night of the meeting, yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm not going to be available for the next week to prepare them, so, you know.
I don't believe that you should be the one they're calling about interpreting their bills either, so. Is there someone you feel that might be able to...
This is something we, you know, Mike can talk about administratively. We don't have to solve that tonight.
No.
It's a suggestion.
You know, any other time, I'd say sure, but taxes are due in 2 weeks, and I hate to be at all resistant, but it's just not fair to anyone in the office. And, you know, I could tell you later on what everyone's schedules are, but, I've got to be practical, and I don't think it would be fair to those remaining, nor to the public to have, you know, not only that, but I don't have time to train the people before I leave. So it's we'll have the material there, and if you'd rather delay the forum for a month until we have time to do that, that'd be fine. But
I think people tend to have those questions after the forum, actually, not before.
So it's best to proceed with your schedule.
Just
some. May I have a motion that we do set this forum?
Oh, wait. Okay, I'll make. Oh. I have a question.
Okay, you have a question.
Comment. All right. Little comment that I think an answer needs to be prepared for the people is why Cape Elizabeth's rate is so much higher than other communities, Cumberland, Windham, Gorham. And you take Cumberland with 2460 according to this, and that was in 594, Cape Elizabeth.
Yeah.
With 34, Windham 1150 and Gorham 1584. I mean, that is what I hear most of, is why the difference. And I think be prepared to explain that.
Councilor Reed.
Thank you.
I'll make the motion that we move this to a public forum to be held on Thursday, September 28th, 1995, at 7:30. I did want to confirm that is in the town hall.
Yes,
second.
Further discussion? All in favor? That's 7-0. Item number 45, to consider a proposed reorganization of the Board of Voter Registration as authorized by a new state statute and take any necessary action. Ms. Lane.
Thank you. As we discussed at the workshop on September 29th, there are many election laws that will be coming into effect. One of them is the elimination of the Board of Voter Registration, replacing it with a single registrar. As I indicated in the workshop, please keep in mind that a vast majority of municipalities in Maine already work under the registrar form of Board of Voter Registration. So we're just really bringing all the communities in Maine under the same guidelines for voter registration. The second part of this is to bring into existence a registration appeals board. Under the current law, if someone appeals the decision of the Board of Voter Registration, it goes to the municipal officers. In this instance, effective September 29th, an appeal of the registrar or the deputy registrars would go to a registration appeals board. Tonight, I would like to recommend that the council appoint myself to serve as a registrar, becoming effective on September 29th, in a term to expire May 7th, 1996. The reason for the May 7th is that the law requires that a registrar be appointed within 10 days after a regular municipal election. And since we vote in May, under the law, you'd have to appoint a registrar within 10 days. That part of the law is something that we'll probably be bringing up to the legislature in the next session to clean up a little bit, whether it be an indefinite term or 3 or 4 year term, et cetera. But for now, that is what the law states. The second part of this, the Registration Appeals Board, the chairman is nominated by the town clerk, which I nominate Marion Holzhauser to be the chairman effective September 29th, the term to expire September 29th, 1999. Per law, that is a 4 year appointment. Under the new law, the two other members of the Registration Appeals Board are recommended by each major political party. The Democratic Town Committee has recommended John Walker, again effective September 29th, the term to expire September 29th, 1998. That is a 3 year term. To date, the Democrats have not submitted a name for an alternate. When they do, we'll bring that back to the council for an appointment. The Republican Town Committee recommends Pat Lang to serve and that Robert Bayross be the alternate for the Republicans. And again, that is to commence September 29th and a term to expire September 29th, 1998. I do not see that this law will change the way we do business here in Cape Elizabeth for voter registration. It only gives municipalities across the state, including Cape Elizabeth, more flexibility when it comes to staffing for either Election Day voter registration or voter registration activities throughout the year.
Thank you. Councilor McGinty.
If everybody understands that, I'll make that a motion.
Is there a second?
Or do you want me to spell it out? I'll reread it if necessary, unless everybody understands.
I think it's fairly clear.
I'll second.
Discussion? Councilor Linnell.
I just want to say that I think that it's commendable that Pat Lang is taking on this responsibility. She has a new baby girl, I just wanted to congratulate her on that, and I'm glad she's doing this.
Thank you. Any further comments? If not, we'll move the motion. All those in
favor? I would think we ought to congratulate John Walker. I mean, each party ought to get congratulated here for taking on the task. I don't think
he
should.
Did he have a baby?
No, he didn't have a baby. But she was recognized, taken
okay.
on the task. If he'd mentioned just a baby, I wouldn't have thought so much about it. But congratulating her for taking it on, I think John Walker deserves recognition also.
Thank you very much. All those in favor of this motion? 7-0. Item number 46, to consider authorizing a lease of space within the town hall to the Cape Courier and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, the Cape Courier is a private newspaper published for the public good in the town of Cape Elizabeth. They do rent space here at the town office down in one of our basement rooms. The rent is $50 per month. and I would recommend that you authorize me to sign the lease for an additional year.
So moved.
Second.
For any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. We have an item out of order, item number 47. Mr. McGovern?
Is this the MMA mail ballot one?
No, I thought it was the poll locations.
Okay, it'll be the poll location. I didn't get a copy of that one.
Oh, excuse me.
We have a poll location request on Coalfield Road, which is off Sawyer Road, assist with the construction of a new home. It came in very late, and they really want to get started on it.
Did you not receive a copy of that this evening?
I think everyone did.
We have that. We don't have any MMA.
No, we don't.
I did, too. It's under here.
All those in favor, is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Is there a motion?
There is a motion now to approve this poll location.
Did we move to take something out of order?
We have not voted on that. You're right.
Did I miss that?
No. We've had too much chatting.
Madam Chairman, I move that we take item 47 as presented by the manager out of order this evening.
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? It's a 6-0. Are you going to vote?
Yeah, I'm voting for it.
You're voting for it. Okay, 7-0.
Madam Chairman.
Yes.
I'd like to ask the manager a question. I don't see many polls in that development, and I don't quite understand why they want this poll. Is it more on private land, at the edge of private, going into a home? Or?
This is actually up on Sawyer, Councilor Jordan.
Two new polls on Sawyer.
It's actually out in Sawyer.
By the intersection of Coalfield Road.
Yeah. Okay.
You have a motion on this poll location?
Madam Chairman, I move that we approve the installation of the two polls as presented in the packet information. It's poll 165-1 and 165.5.
Is there a second? Is that a second, Ms. Reed?
Yes.
All in favor?
I'm sorry.
Any discussion? All in favor? It's a 7-0. I believe the manager has another item he'd like to take out of order, item number 48, the MMA election ballot. May I have a motion to take this item out of order?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Mr. McGovern, would you like to give us some background on that?
Yes, this came in the mail today, and the actual date of the election is the morning of your next regular council meeting. It's the standard ballot of the report of the nominating committee for president, vice president, executive committee members, advisory committee. They list as many names on the ballot as there are positions, so there isn't a choice between different candidates. They rely on a nominating committee. You also would need to designate a voting delegate and an alternate for the annual business meeting, if you so choose. Many communities don't participate in the voting, but Cape Elizabeth usually has. The conferences. Conventions in Augusta, October 11th. I believe a couple of councilors have signed up to attend some or all of those sessions.
What are the feelings of the council? Do you want to nominate those who are attending to represent us and vote?
Oh, who are they?
That's what I was going to.
Is it a secret?
Councilor McLaughlin, has anyone else signed up?
I think we passed around the sheet, and some folks said they'd get back to me.
We did?
We need an alternate.
You need an alternate.
You'll be there, right? We could appoint you as an alternate?
I believe I will be there.
Is that said, Councilor Reed?
I move that we appoint Councilor McLaughlin as our voting delegate and the town manager, Michael McGovern, as an alternate.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. We have someone coming forward.
Thank you, Phyllis. My name is Bill Brimmer. I live on Stonegate Road. I'm here just to thank the Town Council and the Fort William Advisory Committee for allowing the British Car Show to use the field for the preceding 5 years. Bob Morneau, who was the chairman of the event, expected and intended to be here tonight to present a small plaque in appreciation of the Town Council and the help of the town manager and of the Fort Williams Advisory Committee in allowing us to use the fort for the past 5 years. Unfortunately, due to some business disruption in his place of business, he was unable to attend, so hopefully he will be able to present the plaque at a later date. But I'm just here. I came forward to just thank the council for allowing us to use the fort for those years of the past. This year, at the request of some members who live in northern Massachusetts, the event was moved to Wells, and we had another wonderful day yesterday, but frankly, perhaps on the record, it wasn't as nice as Fort William. But thank you very much for all the support we've had for that in the past. We certainly missed it this year.
Thank you very much. There being no other items on the agenda, I'll take a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Thank you all for attending. We'll adjourn this meeting until next month, which will be Wednesday, October 11th, due to the holiday on Monday.